Distinguished guests, brothers and sisters, we have amidst us today a poet, an author, a thinker, a philosopher, a judge. Therefore, a human being par excellence, who has lived the message of Bhagwan Sri Sathya Sai Baba through his profound and benevolent acts in his life. A multifaceted and a versatile persona who has earned for himself respect, admiration, transcending the boundaries of the legal world. Through his acumen and excellence in human endeavor. Ladies and gentlemen, it's none other than the chief guest, our chief guest, Hon’ble Chief Justice of India, Shri Dipak Mishra. Please put your hands together for him. My great privilege, sir, to invite you to give the inaugural address.
Hon’ble Justice Dalveer, Bhandari, Judge, International Court of Justice. Justice Ramna, my colleague on the bench. Justice Radhakrishnan, Chief Justice of High Court of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Mr. Pandya, Mr. Chima, Mr. Sadanand, former judges of the Supreme Court of India, sitting judges of the High Courts from various High Courts, delegates, friends from the electronic and print media, ladies and gentlemen. I think today is 11th of August, 2018. I think all of you think so. You may ask me, why do I remind you the date today? Is it of any significance? Is it of any importance? Yes. You know why? Today I'm going to tell you three aspects that might surprise you. You may not agree with me, but ultimately, that will be the discourse in this conference. The organizers deserve credit to have this conference in such a grand scale. Now, let me start with the first proposition. I will not ask you as school children to raise hands whether you agree with me or not. But at least if you agree with me, do give a smile. First, divinity. Divinity is humanity. It's not that humanity is divinity. Divinity is humanity. Second, thoughtless thought. thoughtless thought is spirituality. Thoughtless thought is spirituality. Third, remaining in constant nowness, remaining in constant nowness is physical and economic morality. Remaining in constant nowness. Now, these are the basic premises which I would like to address. A man went to a great guru. Like I have come to you. All of you are gurus in a way. He said, Guruji, I want peace. I want peace. All of you present here, without any hesitation, I can assume you proclaim to yourselves, I want peace. Ladies and gentlemen, you are absolutely wrong. You don't want peace. The moment you say, I want peace, you are denying peace to yourself and to others. Because the I is there. I want peace. How can I come at the center? If the centrality of idea is your I, peace will never come. If you want to have peace, you have to throw that I. What is this I? You write in English I, it's perpendicular. Anyone who wants to spiritually grow up, anyone who wants to morally grow up, he must abandon this perpendicular prospect, what I would like to call ballooning of perpendicularism, which goes up, goes up, goes up, never to come down. There's a distinction between perpendicular I, that is your ego, and on the other hand, the self-respect. If we say, let peace prevail, like they chanted the Sanskrit mantra, Om Shanti, they did not say, Santing Dehi. That is the greatest culture of this ancient India, and that is the greatest culture Baba had preached. You must abandon that I-ness to have peace, amity, and human values. I will tell the story of a poem to you. By the way, I may share with you, many people call me a storyteller. But you have to tolerate me. I'll tell you some stories from time to time. The poem says, Mr. Sadanand said that you go coconut, arati, and all that. I don't dispute. He's right. A man went with a coconut to a temple. He gave that. He felt happy. The other day he went with mangoes. He was very happy. Next day he went with coconut and mangoes. He did not feel happy. Something struck him. Where do I get these mangoes? From the tree. Where do I get the coconut? He didn't have a coconut tree, he brought it from the market, but it came from the tree. He said, where does the tree come from? The tree is creation of nature. Where is this nature? This nature is creation of creative intelligence, God Almighty. So I am giving the creation of God to creation. Hey Bhagavan, please take this coconut and accept it. What have I got of mine to give to God? I am going to bargain with God or barter with God, which I do not possess, but His creation. And I say, God, take it from me and be happy. God shall not be happy. So he says, God, I cannot offer you the coconuts. I cannot offer you the mangoes. There's nothing I see in this visual world to give you. But I have something which is not your creation, which is singularly and exclusively my creation. That is my ahankar, my ego. Oh God, I surrender my ahankar to you. These are the basic norms of spirituality which are associated with human values. Sometimes one wonders, there is a tussle between science, physics in one way, and the spirituality in the other. We are not going to the theory of creation. Let's not enter into that arena. The issue has to be settled in a different way. Eventually, everyone accepts today in the modern science that there is a different kind of being in the fourth dimension or in the fifth dimension, a spiritual world and higher spiritual world, a world of spirits. If you recognize a fourth dimension or a fifth dimension and you have some kind of a belief that spirit world exists, the consequence is there is an energy world. If there is an energy world, energy, as per science, gets converted. Energy is never wasted. I think there must be some scientists present here, and they will not contradict me, that the energy gets wasted. They do not. That is why Shastrakar, the Vedas say, Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Even you take the whole out of the whole, and the whole exists. Nothing gets away, nothing sinks away. What you have got, you have always structured it. It shall remain as it is, even if you take it away. Is it an ocean? Is it a sea? Is it a pond? Do not try to imagine. Imagination cannot solve the purpose. Rationalization will not answer. The best way, ladies and gentlemen, to surrender. Surrender is the first and basic fundamental part of spirituality. And we have gathered here to learn the act of surrender. Now let's come back to another story. What is this surrender? I must explain to you what is this concept, otherwise Shankaracharya had a debate with Mandan Misra. He wanted to say that Mandan Misra, what he was thinking about the God, was not correct. There's a different perception. He defeated Mandan Misra, a great scholar. Then his wife, you see, my wife is also here. The wives are sometimes very, very fighting for the husband in the sense, no, I protect my husband. Mandan Misra's wife said, Shankaracharya, you have defeated my husband, but you have not defeated me. Unless I am defeated, my husband shall not stand defeated. See, what's the question? The question related to a mundane life of marital purposes, matrimonial purposes. Shankaracharya had no experience. He said, give me some time, I'll learn and come and debate with you. Shankaracharya comes, eventually finds a dead body of a king. The people were trying to burn the king's dead body. Shankaracharya gets into, he could. He abandons his body to the soul, keep it somewhere, body, keep the students, and ask them to keep it somewhere. And he enters into the body of the king, and the king comes alive. But the king comes alive, but he's a different man altogether. The kingdom prospers, there is rain, there is good paddy, good economy, no problem. The queen doubts, this can't be my husband. He was different. So she issues a direction, find out if any dead body is anywhere and burn it. And the dead body was caught. They found out, they're trying to burn it. At that time, Shankaracharya comes to know, and he could know, that my dead body is going to burn. He said, how can I come alive? And how can I debate with Mandan Mr.'s wife? Then he writes, he chants the most powerful mantra of a culture. I will not call it a religion. He invokes the most powerful deity in a different way, Lakshmi Narasingha. It's in 44 stanzas, and every stanza ends in one line, Lakshmi Narasingha Mama Dehi Karabalambam. Hey God, oh Bhagavan, lend me your hand. And eventually the dead body, when goes to the fire, there is a torrential rain, and these people can't burn him, and he gets into his life, he takes away from the, gets into his own body and comes back to life. What is this line? Mama Dehi Karabalambam. This is the essence of surrender. And when you pray to Sathya Sai Baba, oh Baba, save me, that is surrender. You see, you have been told about dharma, artha, kama, moha. Vyasadev, who has written Mahabharata, in Karna Parva says, what is this dharma? You see, dharma is not translatable into any language, neither French, nor England, nor English, nor Greek, or any other word. Because water flows, it is the dharma of the water. I must do dharma. That's a different concept. One must be guided by Raja Dharma, another concept. That is why Vyasadeva in Karna Parva says, I've translated in English, it reads like this. Dharma sustains the society. All of you. Dharma maintains the social order. Dharma ensures well-being and progress of humanity. Dharma is surely that which fulfills these objectives. I would still say an attempt has been made by the author to give a complete sense and a connotative dimension to the word dharma. Possibly some scholars may find it's not complete, but it's almost complete. Let's accept it. It's everywhere. The conference is legal world and the concept of spirituality, dharma, is an amalgam. How the judicial or legal world responds to it, the human values. You see, there's a distinction between human values and human rights. But let's not try to make too much of the distinction. Human values and human rights are to be protected. What is my human right? Protection is on you. you have to protect my human right by expressing your human values. Some human values are inherent, and some you have to cultivate. Nature doesn't endow human values, all of them, in you. Constitution and the laws teach you. And gradually, when you grow up in the society, you have to inculcate the habit as a constitutional mandate that I am a citizen of this country and it's my obligation to have the human values. The human rights of all are protected. You cannot and never should happen. I must enjoy my human right at the cost of affecting or denting the human values of others. I read a passage from a judgment, how the Supreme Court has thought of human values. I am not here on the context, I am here on the expression. The year was 1982. It's a Bachchan Singh judgment. Legal scholars present here may express an astonishment, but this is the expression the judges used. I quote, "It may be pointed out that our constitution is a unique document and is not a mere pedantic legal text, but it embodies certain human values, cherished principles and spiritual norms, and recognizes and upholds the dignity of the man. It accepts the individual as the focal point of development and regards his material, moral, and spiritual development as the chief concern of various provisions. Dignity, spirituality, human values all come encompassed in one passage." It's a constitution bench judgment spoken by five judges, and every concept is here. Why? You see, what time sometimes we discuss, what is the spirituality? Let's digress a while, because I've told about the judgment. Before I go to second judgment, let me have a digression. Is spirituality a blind faith? Have you ever asked your question to yourself? Many people say, "I lead a spiritual life." Others proclaim, "I lead a religious life." Society says, "He is a very dharmic man, very religious man." If you go to a higher degree, he says, he's a spiritual man. I'm giving you thoughts to think. If in a technical session there is a questionnaire, ask them. I'm only giving a thought. Spirituality, please mark my words if you are serious delegates in this conference. Spirituality is not beyond rationality, and rationality is not bereft of spirituality. That is why I always say there has to be an amalgamation, a synthesis, a synchronization between rational spirituality and spiritual rationality. Rational spirituality and spiritual rationality. Have I confused you? Let me clarify further. I'll clarify. It's my obligation to clarify. Think of a ladder. You can climb the ladder step by step. But, ladies and gentlemen, there is a ladder. You have the capacity to climb, but watch your steps. Unless you watch your steps, you will not be able to reach at the top of the ladder. This watching of the steps while you climb the ladder is the rational process, is the reasoning part of climbing the ladder. And similarly, you must first think that there is a ladder, I am the potential, I am efficient, I am capable to climb this ladder. That is your rational accumulation of prowess to think of spirituality. And that comes from your individual propelling, your individual desire to achieve. This element of desire is rationality. And that is why I've associated with rational spirituality and spiritual rationality. Please think over this and now, we are so many people in this hall. Have you asked yourself a question, why are you here? Why am I here? Why I have taken troubles to come? Somebody has summoned me. Come. I summon people elsewhere. But here I have got a different kind of summoning. My spiritual summoning, my moral summoning, come. And this summon, please do not misunderstand. This is kripa, daya, compassion, blessings, benevolence of the Almighty or His representative. There are two concepts, doctrine of ascendance and doctrine principle of descendants. I'll explain to you. In Gita, at one point of time after Arjuna is convinced, after some time, he tells, "Hey Sakha, oh my friend, Lord Krishna, please tell me what you have told me at the war field." Lord Krishna says, "Dear Arjuna, I cannot tell you now." He said, "Why? You told me everything. Starting from my taking note of my visad, the soul and so many things. Now why can't you tell me?" Lord Krishna says, "Arjun, at that time I was yogastha." And he uses the words in a different way, not in this context, and I can borrow from the second chapter. Yogastha kuru karmani sangam tyaktva dhananjaya. At that time, I had no attachment. I was in a state of yogastha. I was in a state of ascendance. What we call avatar. Avatar doesn't come there. It goes from here. That's one theory. It goes from here. That he goes from here and ascends. And he is yogastha and he can tell you, do this. And you feel like doing it. The second theory is, this is called uttinna. Man from the top, below goes to top. Uttinna, ascendance. Then abatinna, he comes down. And incarnation takes place. And that is what also is there in Gita. Sambhavami yuge yuge. Either you accept this, the theory of uttinna, or theory of avatinna, doesn't matter. The world has seen people like Gautam Buddha, Mahavir, Prophet Muhammad, Lord Jesus, Vivekananda, others, Ramakrishna, Paramahansa in a different way, and to some extent, and a great extent to many, where you are present today. Sathya Sai Baba. I can't define whether he was Avatirtha or Uttendra. No. I leave it to you. Ask your souls to get an answer. And this comes because of, I told you earlier, because of Bhagavan, God's love for you, blessings for you. And that is why Adi Shankaracharya, he's an Advaitavadi who doesn't believe there is any kind of a rupa. There is no seen God, a visible God. God for him is Niramayam, Nirakaram, Niravasyam, Niranjanam. But he still says, addressing Lord Jagannath, and I tell you in Kripa Parabaraha Sajala Jalada Sreni Ruchiro Ramabani Rama Spuradamala Padvakshanamukha Surendraira Radhya Shrutigana Shikha Gita Charito Jagannatha Swami Nayana Pathagami Bhavatume. For he surrenders to God in entirety. In entirety. And that is the blessings of the Lord. And that is why the lawmakers, as the Supreme Court says, the lawmakers, the lawyers, and particularly the judges must make the printed text vibrant with human values, not be scared of consequences on the status quo order. The militant challenges of today need a mobilization of revolutionary consciousness. Since we civilized systems cease to exist, remember, we are all active navigators, not idle passengers. On spaceship Earth, as it ascends to the celestial levels of the glorious human future. And that is why in Menaka Gandhi's case, the Supreme Court describes us as Amritasya Putraha, children of immortality. We are not here to die as a human race, but here to progress. And that is why the concept of children of immortality. Can human race survive without liberty? And that is why many people have announced, either give me liberty or give me death. What's the point of living if I do not have the liberty? And Shakespeare puts it through King Lear, where is the man whose soul so dead? You can't make your soul die. You can make your prana lie. Pran goes, life goes. Sans liberty, it is death, because liberty is dearer to life. And that is why in one judgment, a doctor's liberty was affected. Humility, his personality was affected. His reputation was affected. And it was written on his hand. I am a liar. I have done this so many things. An inquiry was made and found that it was all wrong. The Supreme Court granted compensation, but what relates to human values, I read, I quote, the reverence of life is inseparably associated with the dignity of a human being who is basically divine, not servile. A human personality is endowed with potential infinity and blossoms when dignity is sustained. The sustenance of such dignity has to be the superlative concern of every sensitive soul. The essence of dignity can never be treated as a momentary spark of light, or for that matter, a brief candle or a hollow bubble. The spark of life gets more resplendent when man is treated with dignity, sans humiliation, for every man is expected to lead an honorable life, which is a splendid gift of creative intelligence. When a dent is created in the reputation, humanism is paralyzed." Unquote. If you quote, you see, about the point, reputation is affected and you are not a human being. You are dehumanized. Now, I have a serious problem. I hope all of you present here shall take care of it. We treat the dead sometimes, some people treat the dead without dignity. Never do it. Supreme Court says, even in death, a person has the dignity. Sometimes we say, where is the dead body? Oh, it's lying there. It is there. I would request and suggest, please refer to the dead body as he or she. Don't refer it to as it. Take a place today in this conference that we shall never, never refer to a dead man as it or the body. Say, he lies there. She lies there. How do you know he is dead? Spiritually. He may be alive. With your senses, you know not. Refer it to as he or she. I'm not going to much of law now. I'll quote a passage from my conclusion, then I'll go to the president. Today, in this afternoon, it's clear as day that human values are thoroughly intertwined and meshed with legal systems of the world as both together endeavor to achieve social cohesion and a just order in the society. We must understand that the concepts of law and are built on the foundational structure of human values. Once that foundation is shaken, the entire superstructure is likely to crumble or collapse. Law can operate pragmatically when it's infused with human values and informed by reason, fairness, and justness. Include in human values the value of human dignity, identity, rights, fairness, reasonableness, and ultimately in imparting justice with a human touch. Your president has told you all roads lead to Rome in a different way, Sadanandji had said. I entirely agree with him. You know why? There is a very rhythmic effect, but before that I will read my conclusion. Thereafter I will reproduce that sloka. In conclusion, it may be stated that human values are epitomized in many an article of the Constitution, a number of statutes, and the courts in India which actualize them with intellectual passion and constitutional commitment. It's only when law and justice is harmoniously blended with human values that it leaves its indelible footprints on the eternal stands of time and forges its everlasting impression on the lives of humanity. He said, all roads lead to Rome. I'll quote him. What he said, but that's not his nor mine. Akasat patitang toyam. It can be told in a different way. Akasat patitang toyam yatha gacchati sagaram sarvadir namaskara keshavam pratigacchati. Here Keshava means the Constitution of India. Whatever your religion is, whatever your belief is, whatever your faith is, human values, which are inseparable facet of Constitution, all your attitudes, all your proclivities, all your feelings, all your religions, all your aptitudes, all your surrenders must be bounded by the Constitution of India. Thank you for being very present with me.
Brothers and sisters, every word that I used to describe our Honorable Chief Justice of India, a poet, a thinker, a philosopher, this afternoon has been the testimony that every single word that I used to welcome him today to give his inaugural address is actually true. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise to give a rounding applause to our Honorable Chief Justice of India.